There was somebody I knew who had two kids, and they were James and Cameron, and they were on the Malibu beach, and they kept saying, James, Cameron, and then Jim was on the beach looking at this person saying, why is this person calling my name, and they were calling their kids. And that's one of the things they tell young filmmakers when you're making your student films, don't skimp on the focus puller and the sound guy, because those are the two things that if you don't do it right, you have nothing.
You cannot fix them.
But everything else, you know, if you have bad lighting, if you have all those things, you can get away with it. But if it's not in focus and if you don't have good, clear sound, you're screwed.
You're a 25-year overnight success? Is that the...
Exactly. Every overnight success takes 25 years.
But you've been doing this for a long time. I saw your first credit on IMDb, at least, is as a PA on The Abyss.
Yes.
Where did you come from before that? Were you a film school kid?
I started out growing up in a small town called Sun Prairie, Wisconsin, which is near Madison, Wisconsin. I was a kid. I saw this movie called Star Wars, and it blew me away. I mean, I was like, wow, this is a universe, this is a world that I've never seen. And then as the older I got, the more I learned about it and said, wow, there are people who actually make movies and they can do this magic and create this universe and all that. And then the more I learned about it, well, there's this guy named George Lucas who made Star Wars, and he went to this school called USC Cinema School, and I'm like, wow, that's cool. And then when I got in high school and applied for college, I said, well, I want to go to cinema and go to USC. So I applied to USC. Unfortunately, I was rejected the first time, and then I applied a second time and I got in, but it's a private school and my parents weren't wealthy at all and I didn't have the money. So I thought, well, how can I afford to go to California way out there and film school and pursue this dream of being a filmmaker? And I said, well, you know what, throw caution out in the wind, I'll figure out something. So I got two student loans, I had a work study program, and then fortunately I got a scholarship that paid for some of it. So I'm, you know, at USC and I meet all these other kids who are all the best from all their local areas that they were, and it was probably one of the most energetic, creative, fun periods of my early life, where you're just living and breathing film 24 hours a day with all these groups of people and very charismatic people. I remember meeting this guy, John, you know, hey, how you doing? And it turned out to be John Singleton, but you know, and other people, filmmakers at the time. And so it was a lot of fun. And when I finished the first semester at USC in the cinema program, there was a friend of a friend who had this job that was a PA at a studio, and he said, we'd be interested in doing that. I'm like, well, sure, you know. And so I didn't even know what a PA had to do at the time, so I dressed up for the interview thinking I should look good for an interview, and the woman who was in charge kind of laughed and said, wow, you look so good, it's a PA job, you know, do you have a car? And I go, yes. Is it in good running condition? Yes. I just bought the car like a week ago, so they didn't know about that. Are you familiar with Los Angeles? And I politely said yes, and I didn't have a clue, you know. I know how to read a map or, you know, look through. And so they said, okay,
no ways back then.
Yeah, no, you know, exactly.
A Thomas guy.
Yeah. People don't even know what that is, but this big book and you're constantly turning through. And so I said yes to that. And they said, okay, you're hired. And so for 2 weeks, I was just driving around delivering things. And then that was over with. And when that job was over, there was somebody that said, hey, there's a production and they need a study model built of one of the sets. And the art department's leaving. And do you know anything about this? And I'm like, sure, I can help out. So they hired me for a week.
And did you know anything about it?
It turns out I built models as a kid, as a hobby. So here I am, I call up, I'm 20 years old, I call my mom and say, Mom, they're paying me to build models. How crazy is that? All those years of building models when I was growing up, you know, I'm now getting paid to do this. So I build this really fancy model, and I'm pretty good at building models because originally I was gonna get into art, you know, architecture or something like that before I decided to go into films. And so I built this model, and I came in on Sunday and I wasn't getting paid, and I painted it and I aged it. I made it look really, really good, you know. And then the director sees this model and says, wow, this model is fantastic. How'd you like to go to Gaffney, South Carolina and build models for me on this movie called The Abyss?
Wow.
And that was my introduction to Jim Cameron.
And so you weren't really a PA, you were a model builder.
Yeah, for that 1 week when I was doing that. And then it turns out that Jim got his career he started his career with Roger Corman building models, so he could appreciate the craftsmanship and the quality that I did on that. And so then I spent the entire summer building study models of all the different sets on the Abyss to make them. It was sort of before the computer and before previs. That was the way you'd do previs. You'd have a tiny lipstick video camera and you'd line up all the shots and figure out what the sets should look like. And it's a way of a filmmaker to sort of explore all these different possibilities before you build the sets and spend all the money and energy to create them for real.
So did you previs the ending?
Yes.
The infamous and many versions
not,
of the
not,
ending?
Not, well, for a second, when you said the ending, I was thinking my film, not The Abyss. But actually, no, I did not previs the ending. I was more just the live action corridors and various set pieces.
So did you go back to USC?
I did, because the way USC works is, or at least at that time, you have to pick your intermediate 310 partner for a film, and if that person doesn't show up on the first day of filming, then the other person flunks for that entire semester. You get held back. And so I'm here working on a movie thinking I'm going to cinema school in order to go make movies, and here I am working on one of the coolest, most difficult movies, you know, that I've known about. Yeah. And so I was really torn, but I finally just couldn't, you know, in my heart, screw over somebody like that. So I waited till the last possible day and went back to USC, but then finished that semester. And then the following semester, I get a call from Jim, and it's way early in Terminator 2, and he wants me to come back and help him do all kinds of pre-production stuff. And so that was an interesting experience, because I got to learn about casting and about a lot about actors, because the legendary Mally Finn was casting that movie, and I was videotaping all the auditions. So I got to meet all these actors and see the process, and working and seeing Jim work with them. And it was just a very eye-opener, you know, eye-opening experience for me to see and to be part of that and see that go from concept all the way through to the finished film. So in addition to many other aspects that I was doing working with Jim on Terminator 2.
So are you more a graduate of USC or of the University of Jim?
I think it's a combination, because I mean I thought I was, you know, I thought I knew a lot about cinematography and all that stuff before I even got to USC, because I did a lot of work on my own. So I don't even want to say if I was necessarily arrogant, but I felt I was really good at it. And Jim recognized that and saw the talent and let me do, you know, explore that in the capacities that I could. But then I learned so much more from the practical hands-on, actually being there, seeing big productions going and seeing Jim go through all of, you know, The Abyss, Terminator, True Lies, all these movies, and seeing him from the very inception to the finished product. It's a great, you know, film school.
So Jim, I mean, Jim gets shit for being difficult or tough or whatever, but it's, oh, it seems to me like he just wants to get the work done. Like,
yes.
He's hard about the work. He's
not about. Well, he's passionate about it. And so, you know, I'm like that too. When I want to do something, I get so focused and passionate that you really want everything to be perfect and as close to what your vision is. And I've learned over the years the importance in making a movie is communication with all the people. Mm-hmm. Because everybody wants to do their job and they want to do a good job. Nobody wants to just sit there and just phone it in. Or if they do, I don't really want to work with that person. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you know, the hardest part is to communicate exactly what you want, because there's so many chances for that to vary. You say, I want this blue cup here. Well, what if it's a different shade of blue? And then that adds all kinds of problems. You know, it could be a chain reaction. And so I've learned it's just really important to be clear and concise. And also sometimes it's important, you know, even like for giving direction to an actor, don't give them too many things to say, to do or change or adjust, because then it gets overwhelming. You have to be focused and pick like one overriding thing that will improve that performance for the next take, and then they get it, they can focus in on that and concentrate on it. Because early in my career, I learned by mistake that, you know, you start, your brain's thinking and you're all excited because you've had this movie for so many years in your head, and now the actors are breathing life into it, and they're saying these lines, and you want like four different things to be changed, and you tell them all those things, it's too much. But if you focus on one and you get there, and then you can do another take and see how those adjustments are working, it's just a very valuable thing that you learn.
So what was the moment where you started to really think about being a director and not?
Well, I was working.
You've done almost everything.
Yeah, I was working in a capacity where I was working at Jim Cameron's Lightstorm Entertainment, doing a lot of different tasks and positions. And then it was before Titanic started. after True Lies that I got an agent at UTA, and I was out there trying to find some really low budget film, action films that I was trying to get to direct, and I finally.
So were you encouraged by Jim in this?
Or oh yeah, he said go ahead, yeah, go for it.
Were you like excited? Was that like, was there a moment where you thought, okay, I should be going and trying to direct something?
Yes, I always wanted to direct from film school, but you get enticed in this amazing world of, and when you work on movies like Terminator 2 and True Lies, mm-hmm. and you know, it's like, wow, this is like the pinnacle of Hollywood. I'm not directing, but I'm involved in part of this in my small little creative, you know, area. And so it made, you know, at a certain point I kind of had to cut the umbilical and said, you know what, I'm gonna quit and be a freelancer and not have any money at all, but pursue this dream of directing. And the only way to do that is either make a project and try to get people interested in that, and then, you know, write scripts and meet with people and do all that sort of stuff. So I was doing that process before Titanic. And then, I almost had a low budget action film that I was going to direct, mm-hmm. and everything was happening. And then Jim called me up and said he wanted me to direct the second unit on Titanic. And I turned down at first. I said, well, thank you. I'm trying to get my own feature here. Well, no, I understand, but if you can't. And then a week later, I said, what am I thinking? You know, and so then I called him up and said, sure, I'll do it. And so that was an amazing experience. And so after that, then I finally got enough credibility with the success of Titanic and the fact that, you know, I was responsible for 4.5 minutes of the movie. You know, all the underwater stokers shoveling, and then the water come pouring, when the water comes pouring in, and the under decks and so forth. And I at first was a little concerned that maybe Jim would be so overbearing on the second unit on Titanic, but he basically said, hey, I want you to do it all yourself. You know, go shoot the things, you know, cast it, you know, work with the production designers, the camera department. Mm. And the first couple days, he just said, we'll see dailies, it looks great. And he was very supportive and encouraging for me to do things. And it was a great experience. And it allowed me to have a resume piece that now I could say, hey, I've directed, you know, a small section of this amazing film, and here's my resume, let me do something. And that, you know, allowed me to pursue my career as a director, doing a TV movie and then doing a number of other second unit things, some music videos, some cinematography work, and then finally, eventually, all of this leading to the early stages of Avatar, where he called again and I couldn't resist. Because, but actually before Avatar,
well, as a second unit director on Titanic, how tough was that job? I mean, forget about Jim being overbearing. Just doing it, it seems like an overwhelming.
It was pretty amazing. Put it this way. One day I was shooting, I had 50 grip and 40 electric. And that's, normally you have 12. That's how big it was. It was a shot that we had to film the entire Titanic, a wide shot, sinking. Mm. So it was every light on the Titanic. It was the widest shot in the movie of this huge ship. And the crew said it's going to take 8 hours to light. One shot. Mm.
And this is down in Rosarito?
Yes.
In the big tank?
Yes, yes. So.
And then the stuff in the hallways you were doing, I guess, in the inside tanks?
Yeah, yeah, and in the various hallways. Stages and stuff. So yeah, it was an amazing experience because, and it was another thing, I was very hands-on. I loved to get the camera and just handheld and operate myself. And so I was doing lots of things like that with the camera crew and just getting there and getting this very dynamic, visceral shots of all the mayhem as they're sinking and the water's pouring in. And
seems like a perfect setup for this movie.
Yes.
For Into the Storm. Yes. It seems like. You couldn't deal with, you had to deal with as much more water probably then.
Yes.
Still a lot of water.
No, water always seems to be in the equation for some reason. Yeah.
So you went on, so you worked on Avatar.
Yes.
And was that different now that you had some enough other experience?
Yeah, well, the big difference in Avatar was the second unit was pretty straightforward, you know, because we just had, you know, the various thing. That wasn't a big issue. But it was when Jim called me back and he said he wanted me to work as one of the visual effects supervisors on the film, because originally Weta was going to do the whole movie and he decided to split the film into several other visual effects companies to allow Weta to focus and concentrate on the facial capture technology, because they were the only ones that could do that. And he felt if we went to another vendor like ILM or somebody, they could handle big explosions and battles and stuff like that. And since I was the second unit director and familiar with the movie, he said, would you be interested in supervising the, you know, the effects as one of several visual effects supervisors. Right. And I said that was an interesting challenge, since I kind of unofficially did that on Titanic with all the engine room sequences. I literally was working every day with the effects vendor at the time to do that. So it was kind of not new to me. It just I hadn't done it as an official title. Mm. And so what that got me into was learning about all of this virtual camera and the environment that you can shoot in the motion capture stage and all of that technology, which is really amazing because it's a great tool for pre-visualization. It's a great tool for knowing how the shot should be. And it was a whole world that I spent 2 years on that was a great, eye-opening experience of what the future and what technology can bring you. And I've used those techniques in both the feature films I've directed to plan out complicated visual effects sequences that can be very expensive and allows you to sort of manage your money, so you make all the mistakes and you sort of come up with the creation of the scenes in the relatively inexpensive world of the virtual camera, so you're not making all those decisions on the set when it costs hundreds of thousands of dollars a day to shoot.
So is any of the footage in Into the Storm virtual camera?
No, well, it's not necessarily virtual camera. There's a couple, but I was trying to ground it in reality as much as possible. So a lot of the stuff we shot, but there were a couple of all digital shots in the movie that didn't have any real elements in it.
So you went on and did Final Destination 5. So going from Avatar, Titanic, two biggest movies in the history of film, and they said, okay, come do, you know, a fifth sequel?
What do you call fifth, it even? Fifth film in a sequence.
A sequential?
Yes.
Is that like, I'm just happy that I'm doing a full-length feature?
And well, it's interesting because you can be really picky and want to try to pick the best film you possibly can, unless you have some name to yourself or some reason that people would want to have you. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of advice people give is if you get offered a film, take it, because the thing it does is it allows you then to no longer be a first-time director.
So you got to lose your cherry.
Exactly.
One way or the other.
Exactly. And then just make it the best that you can. And I took that franchise and tried to make that film the best I could, knowing that the built-in audience has certain expectations that they want out of it. And so you have to make the film within those parameters, but do the best you possibly can. And it was very well received with the fans, and they really liked it. Mm-hmm. So, and New Line was thrilled to death with the final outcome of it all. So as a result of that, that was the best decision I made at that time, because it allowed me to cement this relationship with all of them and thus get getting Into the Storm.
So more fun than you expected?
Directing? Yeah. Or yeah, I mean, it's always fun. The big thing that I really learned was it's great to finally be the person that finally gets the say on everything. You know, you work with somebody else as a second unit director, you get your little microcosm of what you're doing, and you think you know that this is going to work, and then suddenly the director comes in, oh, I'd rather have it like that. And then you kind of feel crushed because it's close, but not quite what you thought. And then you have to go redo something or make it work. And whereas when you're the director, everybody else is working for you. And so it's fun in that respect. But the thing that I found sort of daunting is just the sheer amount of questions you have to answer all the time. You know, you're bombarded day in, day out with hundreds and hundreds of decisions that you have to make. And any good director loves to procrastinate and avoid making a decision, because once you make a decision, you have to stick with it and live with it. So you learn very quickly how to make decisions quickly and be smart about them and know how to live with them so they don't impact you down the road when you know, things can vary.
So how did this particular piece of material come into your life?
Well, I had finished Final Destination 5. It was released, and I was looking into other projects. And then Todd Garner and John Swetnam, who wrote the screenplay, brought the film to New Line. And immediately, Walter Hamada and the executives over at New Line said, we got the perfect director for this. So I met with Todd and John Swetnam and said, I love the concept. I love the idea. I think we could do a lot of things with the technology now. Mm-hmm. There are certain character things I want to tweak, and there's some, you know, other aspects that I think we can improve in the script, but let's go ahead and make this a movie. And it went really quick. I mean, Warner Brothers was thrilled, and suddenly the thing got greenlit like in no time. And then it was just a question of trying to get the budget to a reasonable number that we could get all these effects. And then the other challenging aspect was having it be what I call a first person narrative film, because there's a lot of films that are found footage genre. And I think the found footage genre can kind of have a negative connotation if you're not careful. careful because it's low-budget horror films that are really shaky and bad camera work. I wanted to sort of explore the phenomena of everybody tweeting, everybody on social network, everybody Instagrams. I mean, we live in a world where that's everybody does it and it's bombarded and it's only going to get more intense with that. So as a result of that, I said, well, let's make a movie in that first-person narrative genre, but apply it to a big epic spectacle disaster movie and kind of bridge the two. But I didn't want it to be so shaky and so bad of camera work that my conceit was, if it's professional storm chasers who are documentary filmmakers, they know how to operate a camera, they know how to compose, so there'll be some cinematic aspect to it when they're shooting. So if we start the movie with just high school students and handheld cameras, and even our lead actor, our lead character, Donnie, he is, you know, the head of the AV club, and he's trying to do these time scales. So he knows about doing, he's like a up-and-coming filmmaker and so forth. So by having these people know how to use cameras, they're going to operate them much better, so we don't have to go too far in this crazy, let's make it shaky and, you know, real, and then it makes the audience sick and dizzy and you don't know what's going on. So it's kind of like a hybrid approach. And then the other thing I did is I really focused on telling the story through that first person narrative in the beginning, but then eventually I kind of let it become more like a natural film, where it's still, if you look at it, you can justify where all the cameras are, but we're doing more cuts like over the shoulders and traditional movie making techniques you would use, and the audience doesn't even notice. It kind of segues seamlessly into that, and they just get enveloped in the story and the spectacle and the ride of the film until the end.
Well, it's funny because there's that airplane sequence, which people have seen in trailers and things, but it's like, oh, where did that come? It's like, it's the only, it only seems to be like the only sequence in the movie that's not a POV sequence.
Right.
Like, it's kind of a, you know, like, there's time for the airplanes. Let's see the air, you know, it gives you context, but it's not,
right.
I don't think anybody's there.
Well, theoretically it is, and what we did is right before that we had aerial helicopter shots of the tornado from the news helicopter when they were going in, and then so the last shot, you know, again, it doesn't matter because it's a movie, but the, you know, I'm trying to justify everything, and so we had the shot of the aerial shot of the big wild, 2 mile wide tornado, and then right after that there was another wide aerial shot that's similar of the tornado, and then we zoomed in to show all the planes. So the conceit was that it was a news helicopter. And at one point, we actually had the news bug in it to tell people that it was a news helicopter. But I found that at this stage in the movie, all of those distracting things like news bugs and lower thirds got in the way of the movie storytelling experience. So I got rid of them all. And so we don't need it. By the time we got about halfway in the movie, we got rid of all that. And nobody missed it. And it just, you kind of just kind of watch it.
So do you, when you start off on this conversation about doing this movie, do you, is it like a... any genre film in some ways, is it like, you know, okay, we need to have, we're going to have 8 tornado sequences, or we're going to have 6 tornado sequences, or we're gonna, I mean, does it play out that way, or is it just naturally scripted to that?
Well, the script had the same number of tornadoes that we ended up in the final movie, which I believe is 4. But we, what I, I'm a
big...
There
are multiples within the...
Yeah. Well, I mean, 4 tornado events, I should say. Okay. You know, they could have multiple vortices within one tornado. But what I did is I looked at it, and I'm a big fan of contrast. And what I mean by that is, you know, if you have a movie that's really quiet the whole way through, you know, it's one state. And if you have a really loud movie with action constantly and nonstop, that's another state. And both of those can kind of be numbing, and you kind of lose sense of whether it's quiet or loud. And so if you can have a curve that goes up and down, both in the sound, the visuals, dark, bright, loud, quiet, and give contrast and dynamic range to a film, both in characters and in visuals. You know, it works along all levels. And then suddenly, the quiet moments are quieter, the louder moments are louder, the action sequences are more intense, and the non-action suspense scenes, you know, it works really well. And so I, like, specifically went through the script and tried to plot this to make sure that the flows were right, that it wasn't just nonstop. I mean, towards the end, it kind of becomes this crazy third act where this, you know, 2 mile wide tornado's coming, and it's, oh my God, we can't even survive in our storm shelters. We just got to outrun this thing and try to get, you know, get to safety. But all the other moments, we needed to bring a little bit of a moment so it wasn't just one after another and try to figure that out. And so that was a conscious effort when we were doing it to pare it down. I also wanted to make sure that the tornadoes were almost like characters. You wanted unique traits with them so that one tornado didn't all look the same throughout the whole movie, but you have different styles. You got thin rope tornadoes, you got big mile wide tornado, you've got a fire tornado, and all these natural phenomena which actually occur, and we had lots of reference video of them. So I was just trying to shape it so it became a fun, entertaining movie, because at the end of the day for me it's like, I love movies, I'm a big fan, I go into the theater opening night, packed crowd, I just want to get lost into that movie and have that experience I had when I was 14 years old or 9 years old. And so I make movies that make me feel good, and I enjoy that experience, fun popcorn ride. And so you do your best and you make all these adjustments and you try to understand how the flow would work. And then it's such a joy when you actually have a chance to test the movie with an audience and they react and if they enjoy it or like it, and it's just really refreshing when that happens. It's like one of the best feelings you can have after you work, a year or 2 years and you labor on all of this, and then you finally get it finished and let the audience see it. I mean, it can be very nerve-wracking beforehand, because you have no idea that first preview screening, you don't know how they're going to react. You think you do, and you've showed it to your friends and people, but then you get there and it's just a random selected audience that are reacting to it. And when they like it, it's like it's one of the best feelings professionally one can have.
And this is really an audience movie. This is not like,
exactly.
This is not an art film where you're going to sit there and have an intellectual conversation.
Exactly.
Visceral response to things.
Yes.
So do you, as you're making a film like this, do you know how intense everything is going to be? I mean, can you ramp up and ramp down as you go into post? How big the tornado is actually going to be, or how loud or how intense the beats are? Because a lot of it's the visuals and not just the shooting of it.
Well, one of the key things, and it's really difficult to judge on a film like this, is when you have all these visual effects and they aren't done, you show it to a movie and it's like this gray, blend shaded blob that's supposed to be a tornado, they're kind of like, the sound isn't finished. And so it's really tough to gauge, so you have
to... It sounds a big deal in this movie.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Well, I was very fortunate that we had Per Hallberg, who's an Oscar-winning, amazing sound designer. He did Black Hawk Down, the Gladiator, the most recent Bond film, and he brought a lot to the sound design. And going to USC Film School, I had Tom Holman, who was the creator of the THX sound system, as a sound instructor, so I really got into sound as well. So it was a lot of fun to work with him to really tune the sound, again, with that contrast and the dynamics, but also to make it real. There are a lot of movies that add lion roars and all these sorts of things to the sound, which is fun. It's like Banshee Screams and Star Wars, and that's great, and they do amazing job, and I love those types of movies, when they're like, Marvel type of superhero movies or Star Wars or any of those, but we were trying to go a little bit more for realism, and so we wanted those sounds to have an impression and be scary, but also be believable, so it was just really nice to be able to work that out and perfect that and have the time to really finesse that and work with such a talented group and team that could make it all happen.
So do you look back at stuff before you do this? Do you go look at Irwin Allen movies?
Interesting. Do you look back or not? I actually do the opposite, to be honest, because I'm afraid that past works will influence me too much and cloud my judgment of what I want to do. So if I'm doing a movie that's like a tornado movie or some other type of movie, I will intentionally not see anything and try to focus on the script so that I get my inspiration from the script and the characters. So that would then lead to have me decide where I want to focus and what I don't. I mean, every once in a while you do have to watch a movie because you come in danger, or maybe you're doing something that's duplicating what they did and you don't quite remember, so you have to watch it to make sure, well, am I inadvertently, subconsciously doing something that somebody else had done in the past or not? But for the most part, I try to avoid that. And when you're making a movie, you're so busy and so many hours in the day, you don't have time to watch movies. But it's between film projects that I catch up and try to see everything that's out there to stay current.
Well, somebody actually referred, it's out loud, of course, in a movie theater, in the first tornado to what they perceived as a reference to Twister. But that was just probably in their head.
Which tornado are you referring to?
I think
to?
It was the first one.
Because in the
There's
middle, in the
involved.
Middle, in the middle of the movie, we did do one little wink, wink. We did an homage to Twister where we had a sign, a steakhouse sign, with a cow on it, and the tornado ripped it off, and the cow flew across the screen. Mm-hmm. So I figured, you know, Twister was such a seminal movie that let's give it a little bit of a way in the background, a nod for those fans who love that movie that was so endearing to them at the time, to say, hey, let's, you know... give nods. And I'll never forget when we were at WonderCon promoting the film, Bill Paxton was promoting Edge of Tomorrow, and so I was having an interview about tornadoes, and then the reporter mentioned Twister, and Bill was right next to me, and leaning goes, Twister, what's that? And you know, I know Bill from working in on Titanic and so forth, and he's just a really funny guy, and so we had a good sense of humor on that. But it was pretty funny to be, it's like surreal to be talking about a tornado movie, and then here's Bill Paxton right next to you, you know,
as like we're the Woody doing Allen gag.
Yeah, exactly. Marshall McLuhan.
Yeah. So you, and you also, your cast, speaking of your cast, speaking of actors, a relatively unknown cast. Your female lead is, you know, everybody knows from Walking Dead at this point, but still relatively little known in the film world. Intentional? Was that the kind of the design of the film?
Absolutely. Together? I mean, you know, movie stars are amazing, but they also bring their baggage of being a movie star. And if you're trying to do a movie that's told in a first-person narrative and you're trying to say that potentially it's found footage, people aren't going to believe it if you've got all these, you know, celebrity actors in it. At the same time, I was looking for the best actors I could find, you know, and so we looked at lots of people, had lots of different ideas, and, you know, when I saw Sarah Wayne Callies, I knew her from Walking Dead, but she actually did a self-tape of a scene when she was up in, I think, Vancouver at the time, and it was horrible quality, you know, bad lighting, all that, but I just immediately, she was Allison, the meteorologist, you know, the intelligence she had, the command that she had, the presence, the softness that she had dealing with her daughter, you know, all these qualities to it that just made her feel real and believable. It was great. And so, you know, it was always fun to work with her because she comes so prepared and has so many ideas about her character and wants to know all the subtle details and does this feel right or not. And, and she also tends to listen to music before seeing to get into the mood that she needs to have. And so it's a very interesting technique that I think worked really well. And of course, Richard Armitage, having worked at New Line, I knew of the Hobbit movie coming out, but we picked him before the first Hobbit was even released. So I thought it would be great to have him go against the type of this super strong, you know, leader that he is in The Hobbit. Here he is in this film. He's just an administrative guy in the middle. He's not even the head of the school. He's the assistant principal and has to deal with some boss who's telling him how to do things. He's got teenage kids that are being rebellious, and he's just trying to focus as a single father. And I just thought it'd be nice to see Richard as an everyday man and then having to rise to the occasion when all this disaster occurs and, you know, just having the love of his son trying to find his missing son in the middle of this disaster so that they can reunite.
And the kids are fun to cast?
It was a joy. I mean, Alicia Denham Carey, who plays plays Caitlin, I'm sorry, was she's an Australian actress, and she was the second person we read for way in the early stage of like the first day, or might even the second day, and she just had this sparkle and energy and intelligence to her that's like, she is that, you know, she is Caitlin, you know, that is like amazing. And so I told the casting director, you know, we gotta hire her. And she's like, but it's the first day, I don't care, you know. And then we saw like dozens and dozens of other people, and in the end that she was just the one. And and then Max Deacon and Jeremy Sumpter, you know, all these actors were really fun to see them take, you know, their parts in different directions and so forth. And I mean, Max did a great job as playing the older son, and he actually has a physical resemblance to Richard Armitage. Yes. And the irony is they're both British and they're doing American accents. So we have Alicia, who's Australian, doing an American accent. We got Richard and Max, who are from the UK, doing the US accent. But in the end, it, to me, it wasn't about actors from what country they were. It was just about what actors that fit right for the role. Mm-hmm. And fortunately, they were all able to do the accent, so it was never a question of, you know, sounding odd or anything like mm-hmm. that. And then for the storm chaser camera operator guy, the key, not the camera operator, but the guy who's leading the whole expedition, right. Matt Walsh, was really fun to work with because he comes from a comedy background with Veep, and he mm-hmm. can do all this improv and so forth. But what I liked about him is he brings sort of an everyday man to it. You know, you get a really intense, strong character who's playing that role, and it might not feel as real. But if you get a guy who's kind of been there around for a long time, he's kind of sarcastic, and he's, you know, at the end of his ropes because he's been trying to get these shots of tornadoes, and he never gets anything, mm-hmm. and he hires this meteorologist to come, and she's all smart and knows all these things, and he's more shoot from the hip, I just want to get cool images. So there's a nice contrast between those two characters. And Matt was just really fun to work with because he'd always crack a joke or do anything, you know, between takes or even during the takes. There was just an unpredictability to it. So it's just a refreshing way to work.
So how far into the process do you know what you have? I mean, are you waiting for effect shots to come in until 4 weeks ago, or are you?
Well, we actually were able to finish it. Let's see, when did we get it? It was probably the beginning of the year because New Line had decided, Warner Brothers decided where to slot it, and there was all kinds of different places, and they felt they didn't want to have it come out right during the time that Noah came out because it's two weather-related things and other stuff. So they were just trying to find a slot that they fit, and that's when they decided for this slot. So it gave us some time to finesse the movie and get it really precise and do all those technical polishes that you don't necessarily always have the opportunity to do, which was a joy to be able to get it done to the completion that I was happy with.
But anytime, like, we have the conversations with animated directors who talk about, you know, all the shots basically coming together in the last 6 weeks of whatever the period is.
Yes.
That they're, you know, they kind of know, but they don't really.
You don't really know until it's true.
Until it's all
even on this
together.
Film, you know, it's an arc. It's a logarithmic curve. It starts like this, and then you get a couple, and then they all come at the very end, and then it's over. And so it's almost like it's too late. If it's going bad, you're kind of screwed. If you know, but fortunately, you work diligently with them, and then as they come, it's exciting and amazing. And once what I did is I had a key shot for each of the different sequences done as early as possible. So if that shot was done, I knew, okay, that's solid, that'll work. And now all the rest of them adjacent, they just have to match the look and the technique of that. And we know those are all going to work if they have enough time and resources to finish it. It kind of gives you a little insurance for that. But
experience pays off.
Well, exactly, because, you know, and the other thing we did is we divided the movie into several different companies, so each different tornado had a different company that worked on just those tornadoes, so they could parallel process. So we're not dealing with one company trying to do everything through that. We could kind of have the other companies simultaneously working on it, and they could all just focus on each of their shots.
So when do you let out the sigh of relief? Is there a moment when all those shots are in and you still have a little bit to do, but you're kind of like, I
let a sigh of relief out when we had our first preview screening, our last preview screening, but our first preview screening with most of the effects in somewhat final to temp final form. Mm-hmm. So it was at the first chance to have the audience see it pretty much the way the movie was going to be released. And that was unbelievable. That was just, I mean, right there I go, I knew, okay, we got a movie now. We just have to finish it and tweak little things here and there. And that was just an amazing, you know, feeling.
And usually not the case with a drama, but in this film, I imagine you could tell exactly where the audience was.
Yes.
Throughout the whole movie.
Yes. Well, I mean, when the end credits went on and we got huge applause, I was surprised by that because this type of movie, you know, usually a very, serious, dramatic type of work or something that, you know, justifies something like that. But the audience just had a good time, and that felt great. I mean.
So next movie without any weather?
I'd love to. Yeah, I'd love to avoid weather or avoid water if possible. That would be a nice thing to do, but you never know. It's always fun, and I just feel privileged and honored to be able to make movies because, I mean, I look at it, and it's kind of daunting. You know, I think Warner Brothers makes between, 16 to 19 movies a year, so I am one of 19 people on the planet, population of 6 billion people, that had the honor and privilege to direct a movie. That's pretty special, you know, and it's, you know, especially like you said, the 22-year overnight success.
And do you have the thing, oh, I really want to do a musical next time, or I really, things I want to do, or is it kind of like, okay, we'll see what the next project comes along?
I have a lot of ideas and a lot of projects that I think would be amazing, but I always feel that anything that has some sort of a world creation to it, you know, element to it would be helpful, because I could then explore it and go someplace and take people to a place or a concept that they maybe haven't seen before. And
so you dig that. That wasn't just foisted upon you by the circumstances.
No, I love it. And that's why I kind of strive and focus for that. I mean, if I had an amazing drama that I thought was great and I had a cast that I love, I'd do it in a heartbeat. But, you know, you get in this industry sometimes, I don't want to say pigeonholes you, but you get in a very specific thing. And to be honest, at this age of filmmaking, there's not a lot of non-spectacle visual effects action movies that are made. There's only a handful of these very dramatic, serious movies that a very small, select group of people are allowed to make, because they usually don't make a lot of money and you have to be careful with it. Right. And so that's a club that's hard to get into. But if you make a blockbuster for a studio and it makes them a lot of money, then my feeling is if you do enough of those, then you will get the box office, quote, you know, credentials to say, okay, let's try something that's a little less mainstream that would be a little more interesting for people to go. And then the best of the world is if you can combine both of those in one movie and get the broad reaction, but still have your creative concerns addressed as you're making the movie. And I think it's just a balance, because at the end of the day, it's called show business, not show art, you know, and they're trying to make money with this stuff. And so you don't want to compromise on it, but at the same time, you want to make something that you would enjoy and the audience would enjoy, because after all, you know, that's what it's all about.